Whether you're fly fishing in a stream, getting those ankles wet, or deep in the ocean casting nets, fish nerds. Fish nerds. Fish nerds. It's a podcast.
It's a podcast. Hello, and welcome to the Fish Nerds, a show about fish, fishing, and eating fish. I'm Clay Groves, Chief Executive Fish Nerd, Licensed Fishing Guide, and your best friend. And I'm super excited because I've got a super special co-host with me tonight. Who's my co-host?
It's me. It's me. Am Knitting Daddy Greg.
Hi, Greg.
Greg. I host the Unraveling podcast, which is a podcast about knitting, crochet, sewing, and other fiber arts. That's over at unravelingpodcast.com. And that's a perfect tie-in for fishing, so that's why I'm here. I also write a blog on knittingdaddy.com. I learned how to fish when I was a kid in Eastern North Carolina. I've been fishing ever since. I've got an 8-year-old daughter now. We love to fish together. My wife loves to go fishing with me. I've been listening to Fish Nerds for a while, and I am really excited and a little bit confused about co-hosting. So this is going to be great times.
Well, I'll tell you, the reason I do this all the time, I get co-hosts on from other podcasts that have nothing to do with fishing, because I sincerely believe everything has to do with fishing. There's not a single topic I've ever come across where I can't connect it with fishing somehow. So whether it's
that, like,
beer,
your superpower?
Yes, it's a superpower. Because, well, when you're a fish nerd, that's all you're thinking about. You're like, oh, well, we can talk about fishing there, you know? So whether it's, you know, any kind of podcast, and knitting, you're tying knots, which you're already there in your hat. You got a hat on today that looks like a fish eating your head. So that's a win.
Yes. I'm wearing the dead fish hat.
The dead fish hat. So welcome to the podcast. I'm happy you're being here, and you'll be with us the whole show tonight. But we have a big show coming up for the listeners, for you guys. So here's what's happening. We have our Fish Nerds fly fishing correspondent, Rich Collins. He's going to check in. He's been trying for years. He's been on a quest to catch a pike on the fly. He finally did it. He's going to come on and share his expertise with you. Tim Beat, our Fish Nerds essayist, is here. He's going to talk all about minimalist fishing, how you can get away with fishing with nothing, and how somehow that leads you to everything. And we have Greg here. We're going to talk more about knitting in a few minutes. And, of course, the news will come up as well. So that's pretty exciting. So, Greg, let's start with you, since you're right here, staring right at me.
Right here.
Right here. You make a knitting podcast. First of all, like I'm gonna come out of the gate a little bit sexist, and I apologize. Generally speaking, in the knitting world, you don't see a lot of big, hairy men. Have you found that to be the case?
That is what I found to be the case before I entered the knitting world. There actually are a lot of big hairy men in the knitting world. You're right. The traditional idea is that, you know, you got some like old grandmothers doing my Knit One Purl Two, making a Sylvester and Tweety, you know, hat or whatever. But it is, there's everybody. There's young folks, there's old folks, there's men, there's women. It's a wide universe over here.
It is. Now, I used to work in childcare at a facility for kids who were removed from their families because of abuse and stuff. Mm-hmm. And they were violent and hard to be around. And one of the therapies the kids used to calm their brains was knitting. Like, they were trained to show them some knitting, and they would just sit and knit and knit and knit and knit for hours to soothe their brain. So do you find it relaxing?
Absolutely. That's actually how I got started knitting. I started knitting in 2012 when my daughter was born, and she was about 10 weeks premature. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, and she was 10 weeks premature, and she's doing great now, but she was in the hospital for 5 weeks before she could come home. And one night, one of the nurses was handing out hand-knitted and crocheted hats to the families that had kids in the NICU. And so we got one. I'm looking at these. My wife's looking at it, and she you know, she's pointing out how beautiful it is, how artistic it is. I'm looking at it, and I'm thinking, I see math here, a lot of geometry, a lot of, you know, like structure and everything, because I'm a software engineer by design, so I see math. And I got my mother-in-law to teach me how to knit the next day so I could start making hats for my daughter, and I've been knitting ever since, so a little over 8 years now.
8 years, and now you make a podcast to go along with the journey that's called the Unraveling Podcast. I've listened, and I knew about 6 words in the first half an hour. So it was very lingo heavy podcast, very, very much for the knitting nerds out there. So
very much a niche. Yeah, yeah,
definitely. Well, that's where the money's at.
Really? Somebody needs to show that to me.
I keep hearing the riches are in the niches, but I, as a podcaster, I've not seen any real
not
money.
These niches. Right.
Not in there. Yeah. It's all, if you did a weight loss podcast or a how to make money podcast, or true crime, right, you might have those niches that you need.
True crime is where it's at.
You need to make a true crime knitting podcast.
With fishing.
With fishing, where fish are knitting. The murder weapon.
That's right. Excellent.
Yeah.
Right. Sword fishing. I like that.
Yeah.
I'm there.
So let's get a bit to talk about fishing, because this is a fishing podcast. And if we talk knitting all day, everyone's going to stop listening.
Right.
Unless they're knitters. So our two listeners, you and someone else, will keep listening who knit. But tell me about knitting and the connection that you have with fishing, because I know you fish anyway. But let's bring them together, and how do they fit together?
So for me, I've got a couple of knitting and fishing stories. The first is, several years ago, I was on a fishing trip with my father-in-law and brother-in-law and uncle-in-law out on the coast of North Carolina. And we go every year to Cape Lookout. We stay there for a week, have a great time. This was the second or third year we went. And we got there, and the first night we were unloading all of our dirty dishes and went to go wash them, and realized we did not have a dishcloth. And we just used paper towels and everything, and it worked fine, but we went through about a half a roll of paper towels cleaning our dishes. I had my knitting with me. I had been knitting socks, and I was going to be knitting some hats during the week, during the downtime. So I ended up actually knitting a dishcloth for us to use.
Perfect.
Yeah. I was like knitting to the rescue right there. And it was great. It was relaxing. It was kind of hilarious. It was the absolute worst dishcloth you could ever have.
well, yarn is not known for a great dishwashing.
Yarn by itself is not, but if you get cotton yarn, that's what dishcloths are made from. Mm-hmm. The yarn I had was not cotton yarn. It was acrylic, wool, and nylon.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah. That's great for a sweater, great for a hat, but horrible for water. But we worked it out. It worked fine for the week. I ended up giving the cloth to my father-in-law as a Christmas present later that year. As a reminder, always pack a dishcloth. I've told the story several times. One of my, many of my friends said, why didn't you just use a t-shirt? Because that would have been a great, that would have been a lot easier than knitting something.
But there's no story in a t-shirt. There's
no story in a t-shirt.
Yeah, so I took my shirt off and washed dishes up. Well, we've all done that. But
yeah,
So to be able to take out two long pieces of wood and knit a washcloth to wash your dishes. That's badass, kind of.
Yeah. it's bad and ass at the same time. So I guess that's badass.
It checks the boxes.
we'll go with that. So, but it was fun. And so that's kind of like a tangential tie-in to fishing, because we spent the week fishing, catching fish out on the coast.
Well, so be specific. What were you fishing for? What were you catching?
We were fishing, really hoping to get some red drum or channel bass.
So this is down what, Carolinas?
It is in Cape Lookout in North Carolina.
Okay.
And we've been going every year for 10 years or so. We don't get the drum. Other folks there, they get drum. We usually get bluefish and some whiting, get a trout every now and then. Sometimes flounder, which we have to throw back because recreational fishing for flounder in North Carolina has a very, very limited season. Get some black drums sometimes. And my favorite is the puffer fish, the Atlantic puffer. And we would throw those back. But we were catching so many, my brother-in-law looked up how to clean them and cook them. And so we get those now. You get a couple of slivers of white meat off of their backbone. and it's kind of like a fish nugget. So it's
not great. Much to it.
Not much to it. And the neurotoxin is not high enough to be concerning like the Pacific version, mm-hmm. but it's great.
That's so, yeah. cool. Well, that's amazing. So I'm glad you got them. And red drum fishing is hard work. I've got a few in my right. under my belt. I went with a guide in New Orleans once, and we're throwing mm-hmm. spoons all day and just missing, not catching anything. And he goes, when I bring clients out who don't know how to fish well, I just put a shrimp under a cork and they catch tons. I'm like, well, why are we throwing lures?
That's right.
As soon as we put shrimp
catching,
under,
not fishing.
Exactly. As soon as we put shrimp under a cork, we started catching them like crazy. There was like dozens of them. Right. I was like, that was so easy.
why make it hard?
I don't know. You know, that's why people fly fish, because fishing right. is, turns yeah. out fishing is really easy. So I've always imagined, right. though, that you can tie flies out of yarn. Is that a thing you've experienced with?
It is. And you got me to do this a month or so ago. I was talking about something and you made the comment, you know, have you ever caught a fish with yarn? And I said, no, but I sure as heck am going to look that up and, you know, figure out what I can do. I actually searched around on Google a little bit, and I found a blog post written earlier this year by a fellow who was catching crappie with yarn, just like crimped to a hook with a slip shot, and it was really easy. And it wasn't even doing any elaborate tying; just taking about an inch or so of yarn and just, you know, smashing it to the hook with pliers and the slip shot. So I said, I bet I can do that.
Of course
you can. Sure enough, I did. Yeah. I'm like, do I have yarn? I look around my house. I got yarn everywhere. Yes, I have yarn. do I have some slip shot? Yes, I do. Do I have hooks? Of course I do. And so one night I made three or four of them up. And the next day or a few days later, we went out to one of the local lakes in Greensboro and did some fishing off the pier. I was trying to see if I get anything off of one of the piers. Nothing was biting, so we moved over to another pond. And as soon as I tossed it in the water, I got a hit, and I was pulling a catfish in.
Perfect.
It was a tiny catfish. Who but cares? Yeah, it was big enough to eat. I mean, I took it home and ate it. And it was great. It was just, it was amazing to have just such a simple a hook with a piece of yarn. It was so simple. There was nothing to it. And I'm pulling in a fish.
Yeah. I mean, my best crappie fly ever tied was a hook with a piece of green string to it and just dangling on the hook, just tied. That was it. Nothing else there. Just a green string tied to a hook. And it caught tons of fish. It doesn't matter. Fish don't care.
Yeah. Fishing's easy, right? Yeah,
fishing's easy. The match and the hatch is pretend. It doesn't matter. Fish are hungry, they're going to eat. So that's right. cool. That's really cool. Well, let's move on here. This Fish Nerds episode, the podcast, brought to you by Spreadem, a portable outrigger for trolling fish. We featured that on last week's episode. It's a one-of-a-kind adjustable assistant for hooking up multiple lines to your boat without the hassle of crossing lines. Everyone that's used the prototype has loved it, and it's great for trolling fish in any boat with your friends. More lines equals more fish. And we encourage Fish Nerds listeners to support. This is a local Maine inventor who built this thing. He's been working on it for years. And even if you can't afford the $400 for the whole piece of equipment, throwing him, you know, $5, $20, every little bit helps out, helps to get his product to market. Go to kickstarter.com/project/Spreadem, or just search for Spreadem, Spread-EM on Kickstarter, and you can help support. And we'll put links in the show notes. We also want to go ahead.
You had a conversation with him on a recent episode, didn't you?
Yeah, last week.
Yeah.
Michael Willett, friend of mine. I've known him since the Fish Nerd started. He's been inventing weird fishing products. He has a lot of cool stuff, but this one I think he's really nailed it on. So
excellent.
Yeah, it's been really cool getting to know him and watching his progression. And I hope he gets to market, because I put in the full amount. I'm all in on this item.
You're all in.
I'm all in. Yeah. So now he's sponsoring us. Maybe I'm getting money back. I don't know.
Well, when you get it, I'll come up and you can take me out on a guide trip. And
perfect. Well, the nice thing about trolling is you got lots of time, so you could be knitting socks.
I'll knit. Yeah, exactly. I'll knit you up a hat while we troll.
In a net.
That's right.
All right. We also want to thank our Patreon supporters for this episode. Go to patreon.com/fishnerds. And we have a brand new Patreon at the $5 level named Nathan Otto. Thank you, Nathan, for dropping $5 in our hat. Anyone who donates at the $5 level is entered to win our monthly contest. And I give away just crap I find in my office. Last month, we interviewed Lulu Miller about the book Why Fish Don't Exist. So I'm going to randomly select a Patreon subscriber. I'm going to mail them my copy of this book, Why Fish Don't Exist. And if I can find some stickers, you'll get some stickers too. And maybe some other crap I got laying around my office. In one second, I also want to thank Beth Metz for donating at the $25 a month level. Anyone who donates at that level, I mentioned their business. Beth has no business, but she will haunt you if you stand in the mirror at middle of night and say her name 10 times in a row. She will haunt your dreams. And Josh Lopes from LopesTax.com. He's giving us $25 a month also. He's also my neighbor. I'm his plow guy, and that's how he gives money. So pretty cool. So let's do the giveaway. I'm going to go to a random number generator. What I'm going to do here, so I have a witness. So I'm not biasing anything. I'm going to share my screen here with Greg so that he can see what I'm up to. And I'm going to go to a random number generator. I've got 40. There's 44 Patreon subscribers, but only 22 at the $5 level. So I've got a random number generator. We're from 1 to 22. There's 44 Patreon subscribers who are giving money, but only 22 at the $5 level or more. So I put them in a spreadsheet, and I'm going to hit generate, and a number's going to come up. And Greg, what number do you see here?
I see 18.
You see 18. So now I'm going to my spreadsheet, so there's no manipulation. And number 18 is Kevin. Let's see. Kevin Kupczyk from Omaha, Nebraska. So Kevin, you are this month's winner, and I have your address, so I will send that to you this week. So congratulations, Kevin. If you want to get on that drawing, patreon.com/fishnerds, $5 a month, and you are in, and you're supporting the podcast. It's just over a dollar an episode. Money well spent for an hour of entertainment, I hope, if you get some value out of it.
I think so.
Yeah, I think it's well worth it. So sorry, Greg, you didn't win.
It's okay.
It would have been weird if you did.
That would have been really weird.
All right. Well, let's jump in. It's time for Tim Beat, our Fish Nerds essayist. He has an essay where he's going to talk all about being a minimalist fisher. And I think we need some happy music for him.
There's nothing like minimalist fishing. Going to a creek with your ultralight rod and a few lures in your pocket. Nothing to weigh you down. And the day stretching out in front of you. I'll admit, it was easier when I was young and didn't have much gear to take. When I was a kid, I didn't know anyone who owned more than one rod. And our tackle boxes, if we had one, were mostly empty. Maybe a spinner or two and a balsam minnow, a bobber and some hooks and weights. Sometimes I went years without even changing my line. To get back to those minimalist days, I called my friend Bud to go creek fishing with me and told him I'd pick him up at 5 a.m. I wanted to get to the creek before sunrise. When I arrived at his house, Bud was waiting in the driveway. I could tell he was deep in thought because when he's thinking, he bites his lip and looks like he's eaten too much Taco Bell. "What's up?" I asked as I got out of the car. "Well," said Bud, "I was watching a YouTube video yesterday." When Bud starts a conversation with, "I was watching a YouTube video yesterday," it's never a good thing. I'm convinced the Russians are trying to ruin my fishing trips by trolling Bud with crazy videos. Bud continued, "I was watching a YouTube video yesterday about matching your lure to what the fish are eating. And the expert fishing guru said the size of the lure can make a big difference in whether you catch fish or not." "That's probably true," I replied, "but so what?" "Well," said Bud, "when I was packing a small box with a few lures for today's trip, I couldn't fit the different sizes I needed in the small box. So I decided to bring a second box." Bud raised his eyebrows, which he always did as a way to ask if I approved. "No big deal," I said. "Bring a second box if you want." And Bud continued, the fishing expert guru said that in addition to the size of your lure, the color of your lures is also very critical. Sure, I prodded, so... Well, said Bud, I thought I should be prepared, so I added a third small box of lures so I could have both size and color variation. He raised his eyebrows again. Fine, I said, hoping this was the end of the conversation. Let's get in the car and get to the creek. It's almost done. Well, Bud stammered, the three boxes wouldn't fit in my hip pack, so I decided to use a small backpack I have. Bud looked for my approval again, as he clearly thought he had broken some rule of minimalist fishing. No worries, I said, trying to reassure him. Bring your backpack. Well, Bud continued, I saw another YouTube video about this guy who was fishing and got stranded during a huge storm. He had to survive on his own for 10 days before he was rescued, and he shared a list of all the essential items he wished he'd brought with him. Now I was exasperated. And, I prodded. Well, said Bud sheepishly, my small backpack wouldn't fit my tent, flare gun, dehydrated food bags, first aid kit, machete, cooking utensils, and winter clothes. Wait, what? Winter clothes? I interrupted in disbelief. It's the middle of July. You never know how long you might be stranded, Bud said with confidence. I scratched my head. We were going fishing in a small creek that was only a quarter mile from a major highway. Where was the guy in the video stranded, I asked out of curiosity. His plane went down on an island in the South Pacific, Bud replied. And I know what you're thinking, he added quickly. We're not flying in a plane in the South Pacific today. That was the most intelligent thing Bud had said all morning. It did cross my mind, I said. But if your car breaks down, we might get stranded in the Dunkin' Donuts parking lot and have to survive on jelly crawlers until we get rescued. But don't worry, we wouldn't need a tent for that. I know the manager, and they're open 24 hours, so we could just sit at the counter until we're rescued. I raised my eyebrows to see if he approved. You never take my concerns seriously, Bud said with indignation. Well, he was right about that. There was the time Bud had read that bull sharks can live in fresh water and bought a set of magnetic anti-shark bracelets that he wore on both wrists and ankles when we went fishing at a local pond. Bud was convinced that we didn't see any sharks that day because of the bracelets. When we ate dinner that night at Red Lobster, Bud was still wearing the bracelets and claimed the live lobsters in the tank backed away as he approached, further proof that the bracelets were a great idea. And then there was the time Bud was convinced aliens could read his mind and lined his fishing hat with tinfoil as a precaution. The funny thing was, Bud only cared about aliens reading his mind because he was afraid they'd steal his secret fishing spots. Otherwise, he was an open book. When I suggested that he invent a bracelet that could both repel sharks and prevent aliens from reading his mind, Bud was not amused. Although I know him well enough that I'm sure he worked for several weekends on the project. So I urged, put your large backpack into your car and let's go. I felt good that I'd closed the conversation. Bud didn't move. There is the matter of the emergency generator, he said. Please don't tell me you plan to carry a generator with you while fishing the creek, I pleaded. Of course not, Bud assured me, as if I was being silly. I couldn't carry that much weight while fishing. Phew, I responded. You had me worried there for a minute. Nothing to worry about, said Bud. I went to the store last night and bought 50 extension cords. I can leave the generator running by the car, connect the extension cords, clip the end of the final cord to my backpack, and I'll have electricity with me the whole time we wade up the creek. When Bud shares his ideas, he often leaves people speechless. This was one of those times. I scratched my head again. Bud, that is a great idea, I said. As you know, I'm not wearing shark repellent bracelets. So if I get attacked by a bull shark in the creek, you can whip out the electric fry pan you have in your backpack and make me bacon and eggs for breakfast while we wait for the rescue helicopter. Exactly, said Bud, and you'll thank me for it. But we can't take my car. This actually wasn't a surprise because Bud's car was often out of commission. Broken again, huh? I asked. No, it's running fine, said Bud. But there was this YouTube video that said you should always have gear on hand for the largest fish you might catch in the body of water, which would probably be a 2-pound smallmouth bass I offered, or a 400-pound bull shark Bud countered. They can live in fresh water. All my heavy saltwater gear won't fit in my car, so I rented a truck. We need to go pick up the truck on the other side of town, come back to my house, load up my gear, and then we can head to the creek. Are you sure you have enough gas for your generator? I said sarcastically. You're right, Bud agreed. We should pick up an extra gas can and stop by the gas station on our way. By the time we got to the creek, it was noon. While Bud was unloading the truck, I saw a kid ending his fishing day and asked him what he'd caught. 94 smallmouth, he said excitedly. You should have been here at sunrise. The fish were busting everywhere. I forgot my tackle box at home and had to fish with the same lure for the entire day. Good thing I didn't lose it. But now that the sun's high in the sky, the fish have turned off. I sighed. So much for being on the creek before dawn for some minimalist fishing. But so the day wouldn't be a complete loss, I said, "Hey, kid, I'll give you $5 if you go tell that guy unloading the truck that you saw a huge bull shark in the creek today." "Sure," he said, snatching the bill from my hand. "But who would ever believe that?" Well, I know at least one person.
Well, thanks, Tim. That was a lot of fun. Thanks for sharing that essay with me. Greg, what'd you think of that essay?
That essay was amazing.
Remarkable. He's a great writer, and we're so lucky to have him on the podcast. So what was your favorite part?
The part where he talked about it being minimalist.
Yeah, totally good. So, all right.
The best.
So good. So good. So that was Tim B. We appreciate that. So I think it's about time that we jump into some fish in the news. Greg, I asked you to bring a couple of news stories with you, and I brought some with me as well, so we can jump in and talk about the news. Let me just hit this magic orange button.
News, news, fish in the news. Everybody loves their fish in the news.
Everybody loves the fish in the news
button. Yes.
Oh, I love this mixer. Thank you, Patreon people, for giving it to me. Because I can just hit it anytime I want to. All right. Yeah. So, Greg, you brought some news.
I brought a piece of news. This is from the Coastal Review Online. It was an article that came out on October 19th this year by Catherine Kozak. And it is titled, "Lakes Health Requires Ridding It of Carp." So this is a, I'm not going to read the whole article because there are a lot of words in it.
So many words.
But it's actually really fascinating, and I recommend everyone take a look at it. But this is in Hyde County, North Carolina, and Catherine tells us that as engineers start work on designs to manage the water levels and flooding at Lake Matamuskete, restoration of its water quality depends as much on a new plan to remove 99% of the invasive common carp muddying the lake.
Mm.
Unless they're gone, water won't clear, lake plants won't come back, and pollution will worsen. So they say currently there is more than 1 million carp, a total of 4.3 million pounds of body mass swimming in the state's largest natural lake.
That's crazy. So
it
much
is absolutely carp. Crazy. Now, yes, there's a lot of carp.
Yeah. So what do they recommend people do? Just go out and kill them all?
They are actually partnering with an organization. They've got a grant, and they are going to put some traps on the canals that feed into the lake that should trap the carp, but not trap other fish and crabs that come through. They're carp barriers on the tide gates. And these barriers are not going to block the other fish. And they're also going to hire some commercial fishermen to come in and just catch as much stuff as they can. They'll take the carp out. Anything else they catch, they'll put back in the lake.
Interesting. And they don't say what they're doing with the carp once they get them out.
Yeah. What would you do with 1 million carp?
Well, 1 million is a lot, but they're edible. I mean, you could totally just have it. You could feed the countryside there, couldn't you?
You could. And this is a very rural area of North Carolina. I've actually been there. And it's really interesting because all around this lake is a lot of farmland. Historically, mm-hmm. it's been farmland. Right now, a lot of the stuff that's immediately on the edge of the lake are duck impoundments, where people have created impoundments for attracting duck for duck hunting.
Right.
And that's contributing to the problem as well.
Because duck poop is no good.
They're adding a lot of fertilizer to the lake that is not getting consumed. And that's killed off a lot of the vegetation. That's, you know, the subaquatic vegetation. And then the corn that they're planting is also not getting harvested and taken off. It's also decaying into the lake. And so it's just changing the whole makeup of the lake. It's a
big mess. And we learned a few weeks ago, Doc Martin interviewed a scientist and we found out that that ducks can eat carp eggs and then they travel in the duck shit, and that's how right. they travel. They can, so there's a huge problem.
Right.
Yeah.
So what happens? We get the carp out and then the duck go eat some carp eggs and bring them right back in.
Yeah. They haven't found a lot of examples of actually happening in the wild. They said it's possible, not a norm.
That was one of my favorite stories from the podcast. I love that episode.
Doc Martin's pure gold, by the way.
She is. The best.
So they don't tell you, there's a long article and it's a lot of these coastal like online reviews and nonprofits who write these articles. They go into like detail. They don't say how the carp got there or why the carp were brought there to begin with.
They did mention that the carp have been there for several decades. Right, so they're not a new phenomenon. It's just that several decades ago, the lake was healthier. And so it wasn't a problem. So it's a problem now. Don't know how they got here.
Yeah, the carp were brought to the United States as a food fish. It was thought that they would become mm-hmm. the normal food people would eat because they get huge. You get a lot of meat off of each one. And they're an efficient fish to eat because when you get one big carp, you can feed a lot of people.
Right.
They just never caught on in this country as a food fish. And they are delicious. So you can totally eat them. I highly recommend if you catch one, if it's not in high mercury level waters or something, you go for it and you eat it. People don't eat them, but they're really, really good.
Right. So. Yeah, I was looking. I've never had carp. I've never caught a carp. I've never eaten carp. And I've heard that it's not a popular fish to eat.
Nope.
And so I was looking about it. And some of the things I found said that because they're rooting around in the mud, you know, they've got a very strong taste. And, you know, that's one of the reasons that folks don't like them. And so some other folks were suggesting if you wanted to eat a carp, catch your carp, then put it in fresh water for 3 or 4 days and then take in, you know, then eat it after that. So. Right.
Yeah, that's a recommendation, but they're not bad. I made a gefilte fish out of it when we caught our carp. I was on the quest to catch and eat every kind of freshwater fish in the state.
Right.
And it tasted like a fish meatloaf, and it was delightful.
Yeah. I'm down for that.
Horseradish
I'm
down sauce. For that. Great. I could totally eat carp again. The problem in New Hampshire, where I live, is the carp are all full of mercury. So you end up with some problems, you know, there.
Right.
Yeah. Well, that's cool.
So anyway, yeah, that's my story about ridding. The lake needs to be rid of carp. If you read the whole article, you find out that's just the tip of the iceberg. You know, there's the duck problem we talked about. Also, mm-hmm. all the farmland nearby is draining into the lake as well. And so that just compounds the problem. And the whole area, everything in that area is at or below sea level. Mm-hmm. So it's a very flat area with our rising water levels because of climate change and everything. The lake itself doesn't drain like it used to, so it won't flush out. So there's
it just gets worse
not
and worse.
Moving out. Yeah.
You'll never get them all out.
Yeah. Well, they're hoping by 2023 that they'll have them all out.
That's a short window. See. They need a bunch of kids, need to get the schools involved and get a bunch of kids out there with fishing rods and just do them one carp at a time. The kids would never get tired of it.
I would go there for that.
I would too. I would totally
let's do it. Let's do it.
Thank you for that. I got a story from the New York Times.
Okay.
It's big. I'm going to play a little audio, a little jingle to help you think about this story. It'll help you get in the mood. Feel free to sing along. Baby shark, doo 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 doo. Baby shark, doo 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 doo.
Baby shark, do 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 do. Baby shark,
baby shark.
Mommy shark, do 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 do. Mommy shark.
Do the hand motions.
Oh yeah.
Mommy shark, do 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 do. Mommy shark. Daddy shark, do 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 do. Daddy shark, do 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 do. Daddy shark, do 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 do. Daddy shark.
Daddy shark.
Grandma shark, do 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 do.
She's got the knitting needles.
Oh, yeah. That's our earworm for this this story. This is a true story from New York Times, so we know it's well researched. Jail employees face charges after using Baby Shark's song to punish inmates.
Oh, wow.
Inmates at an Oklahoma jail were handcuffed to a wall and forced to stand, this is true, and listen to the ubiquitous children's tune on repeat.
Run away, indeed.
Oh, they go on and on and on. I don't know how much more I need to share with you, but three former jail employees... Oh, it's still going. I got to stop it. All right.
Doesn't the Constitution say something about cruel and unusual punishment?
It doesn't say anything about sharks, though. Three former jail employees in Oklahoma are facing criminal charges after they forced inmates to listen repeatedly to Baby Shark, the popular children's song. This is absolutely true story. Kristen Miles and Gregory Butler, both 21 and former Oklahoma County Jail detention officers, as well as their former supervisor, Christopher Hendershot, were charged on Monday with cruelty to prisoners and corporal punishment to an inmate and conspiracy, Oklahoma County District Court records show. On at least five occasions, it happened five times, in November and December, involving five inmates, each separately. Mr. Miles and Mr. Butler placed the inmate into an empty attorney visitation room, and the two then handcuffed the inmate against the wall, forcing him to stand for as long as 2 hours, and Baby Shark was playing on repeat through a computer while the inmate was forced to listen. The song was a joke between Miles and Butler, Mr. Miles told investigators. So,
wow.
Be careful with how you torture your inmates. What song, if you were choosing a song to torture someone with, what song would you choose?
Anything by the Dave Matthews Band.
What would you choose?
I don't know what he has, but his voice just freaks me out, man.
It's really freaky.
Yeah. He does a good version of that Long Black Veil, that Johnny Cash song, or Lefty Frizzell song, I guess. But all of his original stuff, not my cup of tea.
I don't think I heard the name of the artist he said.
Dave Matthews Band.
Oh, Dave Matthews.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Look at that. I'm just going to get everyone to hate me now.
I know. Dave Matthews Band, he's my best friend.
Yes.
I'm a DJ on the radio. We play a lot.
Right. Oh, yeah. Well, there you go.
There you go. I think I would play Cardi B or one of those kind of songs. But
right.
But yeah, but that's a true story from the New York Times. So you know it's true, well-researched, and... That's Baby Shark. So that's fish in the news. Let's wrap that up.
Whether you're
wrong button.
The orange button, Clay.
Orange button. I'm learning. I should label my buttons, then I would get it right every time.
Right.
All right. So now we are joined by our Fish Nerds fly fishing correspondent, Rich Collins, who is going to talk all about fly fishing for Pike. I interviewed him last night. We did a live stream on Facebook for those who are in it. And so we're going to put that right in the show right here. All right, fish nerds, it's our lucky day because Rich Collins, our effing fly fishing correspondent, is here with us tonight to talk all things fly fishing for pike, because he is an expert pike fisherman as of this weekend. Hi, Rich.
Expert, the most moody creature in the world. Yeah, right. I don't know if anybody's an expert on fly fishing for these guys.
But you did it.
Well, I had a little help, yeah. I go with Mason from White Mountain Anglers. We've gone many times. And he tries to school me on how to do it better, and I usually don't listen. I think last time we went, I gave up, cracked a beer, and got a spinning rod, and was like, "Screw this!" And then I watched his cousin catch like a 55-inch on a fly right in front of me, and I just sat there going, "Why do I quit?" So it's a patience game, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's my experience with pike fishing overall. Is it's mostly a fail game until you don't fail anymore.
Unless you're trying to catch bass, then you catch them all the time, right?
Which is fine.
Well, some people get annoyed because they bite through the line and they destroy lures and they eat the plastics and the rubber and all that. So a lot of people get mad at them, but.
So you were saying you went with Mason Thagoras from White Mountain Anglers.
And, yeah, yeah.
And where'd you guys go?
Connecticut River, same place everybody goes. It's the only place. You know, Moore Reservoir, I know a little bit better than the lower or parts of the river. Comerford Reservoir, I went by myself once this year trying to find something. But we go wherever there's water, I guess, now. It's the 2020. So just the main part of the river.
Yeah, and with our drought we've had here in New Hampshire, the water's been kind of wonky. We were, at least in Conway where I live, we had no water for the last month. And we only just got our water back on this week. So I finally took a shower.
I could smell you through the mic.
So let's talk. So you went with Mason. This is like your 10th time going for him.
Well, yeah, I've gone quite a few times for the fly only. I go by myself. I never get anything because it's really hard to man a boat and work for these fish. The fish have, I don't know if it's 1,000 casts or 10,000 casts, but they're just so moody. They bite whenever they feel like it. They're not consistent. So it helps when someone mans the boat.
Yeah,
for sure.
I've only ever caught them through the ice. I've never caught one in liquid water. So,
well, it is water, huh?
It's water.
Yeah. They're not particularly hard to catch. They just aren't very. They're either on or off, or they don't care. They're apex predators, so they do whatever they want. If something looks good, they bite it. Everything else, they stare at. If they want to bite your hand, leaning off the boat, they bite it or whatever. So they're apex. They can do whatever they want. So there's no like. That I can see logic to their biting patterns. And then they say barometric pressure and all these other things influence them, the moon. But I don't know about that.
All right. So let's talk. So you, for gear, you just use some regular old, like what kind of fly rod are you using?
Seven weights with just regular floating line or sinking line and a piece of 50 pound test on the end with a fly.
So instead of using like a wire leader, it's 50 pound test.
Yeah. And it's hard for them to chomp through 50 pound.
They got monstrous teeth.
And then what? Yeah, and they can see. So I started this. A woman by the name of I forgot who makes. Somebody makes these flies, and she gave me a few of them, and then I showed Mason, and he was like, "I'm going to tie those." Nomi Buckman is her name. She ties big predator flies.
Nomi Buckman is
a good Nomi Buckman. And I remember, I don't know that Mason went for pike much either back in the day. So I had like four of these brand new mint, like hand tied, super lightweight flies, and he was like, "Dude, these are cool." And that's what, I don't know, we've been doing this for years. That's what we started with. And now he's cloned that fly. He's made it his own. The one that we were using the other day, he put a rattle in, a glass rattle, which I think helped because the water was super murky because we got 10,000 inches of rain in one day. So they're just big, hairy, gunky flies that look, I mean, we like hot pink. I don't know why.
I think hot pink's my go-to most first choice of any color for lures or flies. If I find hot pink, that's what I start with. Cause it's,
and I never use pink flies. Somebody told the fish nerds had like a contest and I got a pink fly in the mail and I used that until I lost it. It was
did you catch fish on it?
Yeah. It was like a bugger, a pink bugger.
It was a bugger. It was tied by Frank's Fly Arts.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Michael Frank.
So casting these big giant flies, I'm not a big fly fisher. I'm terrible at it. In fact, I broke my fly rod this spring and I never hit it up again. So
not much point now.
So tell me, is when you cast a giant fly, is there any technique difference or is it fly just as good as anything else? Or is it?
It's like total technique. It's not two-handed, although I'm sure you could do it, but I striper fish quite a bit with a fly rod. So long, hard casts, a lot different than the elegant presentation of a trout cast. So you just got to chuck it, and you got to get it to go pretty far because they're spooky. They're super spooky. So the farther you can go, you know, the more likely you are and the more water you can cover. So that's the thing with a spinning rod. You can cover tons of water fast.
With, like, right, because you can cast a mile.
Yeah.
Especially with a fly. It's like a plug that weighs 8 ounces. You can just cast it across the river.
Right, right. So a fly gets really old really fast. And if they say, you know, fish of 1,000 casts, 1,000 times your arm starts to fall apart. You whack yourself in the head when the wind's blowing with that fly. It's like, oh, it gets really old. So I usually peter out and turn to a spinning rod.
Yeah, I can see the fun of getting to a beer fast.
Well, I don't think we had a rule, but this time I'm like, I'm not bringing beer. I'm not bringing a spinning rod, and I'm going to catch a damn, you know, one of these on the fly, because it's been a long time. And every time I do go, I catch a pickerel, which doesn't make any sense.
Which is nice, but not what you're targeting. Now, when you went out this time, does time of day matter? Did you go like this, right at the, you know, butt crack of dawn, or was it midday?
Well, it's kind of a funny story, because we both had to drive through this blizzard snowstorm about 10 or 11 o'clock in the morning. Right. All through the mountains, there was snow.
Yeah, we got 9 inches of snow in Jefferson.
Yeah, well, that's about where we were. Yeah. So he's towing a boat through the snowstorm. I'm going through all the notches, and luckily my truck has big knobby wheels, but I'm like, oh, I might not make it. And then I'm like, it's all part of the game. It's part of the quest. Mm-hmm. So off we went, met up, and then the sun came out. So it was beautiful the whole day after we got there.
Yeah, it turned out to be a really nice day. It was right after that big snowstorm. Now, when Dave Kelm and I were chasing pike for the quest to catch all the fish in New Hampshire, we tried it in the summer a bunch of times. And we saw pike, but they never ate anything we were throwing at them. And then we had a big pike quest day. We invited all our Facebook friends in one day to go pike fishing on Halloween. It was back in 2011. We had like 8 canoes in the water. It was like 25 degrees out, windy and snowy, and not a single person saw a single fish in about 6 hours of playing.
Yeah, that's pike fishing.
And that's with an army of fishers in the water determined to get one fish for the quest.
Yeah, that's about right. If you want to catch them, they're not there.
Yeah, so you got on the river, and how long on the river before you caught them?
It wasn't too long. It was like we were in the shallow spot where sometimes you'll see them feeding and like feeding on minnows, so we... Mm-hmm. Fish that, and like, huh, no fish. And then meanwhile, poor Mason, he's like, I can never help this guy catch a pike on the fly. And then we're both like nervous, because I'm like, I drove all this way, I do this all the time, I'm whatever. And then I like flipped it over. I remember I flipped the fly over into a deep spot. We were fishing the bank. I flipped it the other way for kicks. I was noodling on my phone, whatever, put the phone away, did like 2 strips, and then bam, there it was. There was the one that we took the picture of, which wasn't even that big. It was just like such a prize, because it was so hard fought. Like, I don't remember how many times I'd been out and not gotten one, like 3 times on a fly. How big was he? Oh, it was like 10 pounds. I mean, he was bigger than any trout I caught all year all across the whole country.
Right.
So it should mean something, but I'm like, it wasn't big enough, because you got to hit that like 50 inch point to really, you know, yeah, brag.
When we were on the quest, the one we got was, I think it was like 37 inches ice fishing.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, that's good size. That's good.
And I got lots of smaller ones, but we had to eat one, so we had to keep that big one.
We got a smaller one too, but we held it up to the camera as close as you could, but it just didn't. It just didn't vibe.
So after you caught that one fish, you're like, okay, we're done. Let's go home.
No, absolutely not. It was like the skunk was off. So it was like, whew, this was totally worth it. Driving through the snowstorm, getting the boat in, all this stuff, climbing through the mud to get the boat in. And it's like, okay, it's worth it. And then we fished some more. And then nothing. And on the way back in, just same thing out of nowhere. A little one hammered the fly. And that was it. That was our day.
Yeah, you know, 2 pike day is a good day.
It is a good day. My good friend Andy in Connecticut wanted me to go with him with this like pike expert named Pogo. I don't know the guy, but he's a pike guy. Yeah. Yeah, Pogo the pike guy. And he fished 2 days in the rain. And on the second day, on the 7th hour, he got one bigger than mine, much bigger than mine. So that happened like the day before. So I was hell bent on, I got to get something. So I tried to hold the fish the same as he did, and his is bigger.
And you're like, oh, pointing at the camera.
I know. Normally, I don't even like try to pose. I just hold it. I'm going.
Yeah, but you earned that one. So Mason, like Mason went to guide school with us. You went to the same.
Yeah, right.
You went to guide school with me as well. And I can't imagine. Like I have, like I guide for lake trout in the worst lake in the state, and skunks are painful. But you expect at least to get like one lake trout. But on a pike trip, you kind of expect a skunk. I wonder. I'm sure I had Mason come on the interview with this one. How was he dealing with the skunks in the last few trips he had with you?
Well, remember, it's just me not catching them. Usually, if we're with someone else or he casts. Like that kid can fish. I mean,
he's good.
His cast is amazing. And I don't know what he does, but he's good at it. So, no, it's me that doesn't catch the pike usually. Someone else does. Or it's usually not a total skunk, though. I think the last time we went, it was total skunk. But I also think we were fishing for trout. So, I don't know. I go out with Mason a couple times a year.
Yeah, he's a good guy. So now what? You got your pike? Are you done?
Well, now I want more. Yeah, retire? Now I want a big one. I need a bigger one. I don't know. It's something about watching those things creep up because they come up to they just at the speed of light come up, stop with their nose right on those flies, and they look at it, and you're like, "Ooh, this is going to be it." And then they either bite or they go away.
Yeah. Now I've never seen it with a pike on video, but I used to fish. I used to ice fish with a video, and I would jig for panfish where pickerel lived. And so you have like a tiny teardrop jig and a little maggot on there. And the pickerel would swim up to the jig and stare at it for like 3-4 minutes. And then the most surprising thing about a pickerel, and I'm talking about pickerel because they're in the same family, is the pickerel would come up and nibble the maggot off the jig while I'm watching it. And I never wouldn't even feel the pickerel on there. Mm. Like they can be that stealthy. And so I imagine a pike is like that times 50, you know, just a bigger, stealthy.
Oh yeah, crazy.
Thoughtful almost.
Whenever you see them, they're in like 6 inches of water. Like they're, you know, their fins are almost out of the water. The big ones, they just sit there in the sun and ambush things. It's pretty cool.
Yeah,
but I like pickerel too. If they just don't get quite as big.
No, but you've got some big pickerel in this quest that you've been after. So
yeah, nice. In the time I went out alone. I didn't even know. I know the difference between the two. I can't always tell, but I know chains versus like little beans on a northern pike. And I was out there for 6 hours, whatever, just casting. And I finally caught something. I took a picture, threw it back in. I didn't register that it was a pickerel.
You were suffering from wishful thinking. You put it on Facebook and everyone's like, pickerel. You're like, I hate you. Why aren't you?
Yeah. And I'm like, no, it's not. And then I look at it and I go, oh, it does have the line under the eye, but it didn't have real bright chains, but the color of it. And I was like, oh, damn. Because I thought,
once you've caught a handful of pike, it's like a smallmouth versus largemouth bass. Like you don't mix them up anymore. You're just like, oh, that's, yeah, obviously.
Yeah. Yeah.
You get they're like old friends. You just know them.
The weirdest part is that river usually has smallies everywhere, which are more fun. They're more fun to catch than pike anyhow. They're just not as fun to watch. But we didn't catch any smallies. I don't understand it. They're always around. They're so much fun. But they were all down, so it's weird.
I think with the water temperature dropping a little bit, that with the snow coming in, I think the fish just changed behavior on you and just got lucky with the pike.
Yeah, and it was really weird because there were lily pads all through, you know, the bank, the shoreline. But the water was about a foot above the lily pads because they topped out where the water was low. So there was like this layer of cover a foot down of lily pads, like a wall. But the fish weren't coming up through them. You know, you could drag a fly through it on top and not snag up. It was kind of cool, but they weren't ambushing. They were very... So
the most horrible pike story I ever heard was I was in Bennington, Vermont, around the Connecticut River, and I went to a sporting goods shop there, and I asked a guy about pike fishing, and he told me the story when he was a kid. He used to pike fish using live ducklings for bait.
Yeah, I know this story.
Yeah, so he would take a treble hook. He wouldn't hook the duckling. He would put a rubber band around the duckling and then let the duckling run across the lily pads and then wait for the pike to explode through them, and they would raise ducklings just for bait.
Yeah, that's cruel, but, you know, what are you going to do?
I would think like a wind-up duck would be the solution.
It's probably like a rubber worm versus a real worm. And the pike's like, I've eaten those before, and that one looks funny.
That one looks,
well, the little feathers.
I wonder, though, I never read anything about it, but I wonder if pikes have really good eyesight. Like, are they like... seeing the details of those flies or the details of your lures in a way that like a bass maybe doesn't notice, or even a pickerel for that matter, because maybe that has to do with why they're so hard to catch.
I don't think so. I think they're just moody.
Hit them just right and they'll eat it.
Yeah. And then hit it in the right day and you'll get a dozen. I think it was the first person I think I ever fly fished for pike with was Bill from Lobstick Lodge, who likes pike in his spare time. He's a trout guide, but he's like, want to try pike? I'm like, yeah, sure. And I would ask him, like, what do we do? What are they doing? He's like, whatever they do, you know, don't try to figure it out. You'll go crazy. Yep. You just stop. And I can't, because I'm always like, there's got to be a pattern. He's like, nope, they're moody. They do exactly what they want when they want, and no one tells them what to do otherwise. That's part of the allure, I guess. But
well, you did it. Congratulations. Well done.
Yeah, another fish. But now I got to get more. There's like still time left.
There's still time. So, well, we're not making a whole hour long pike talk. We're just doing a
little. Oh, I meant for fishing. Still season. I still got some more time to go. I'm trying to figure out
when. Pike season's open all year, right? There's no closed.
Not that I know of. No, not in the Connecticut.
Yeah, the water, the temperature, the air temperature just gets cold and.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, usually it gets nasty, rainy, miserable in November. So it just gets.
I wish we lived a little bit closer to that river because I would love to fish that more.
So I
used to go to the setback over in Lancaster, New Hampshire, and go pike fishing in the wintertime. And that was like, you had to drive into Vermont, then onto a farm's back property, and then access through some common use land.
Some guy's lawn, yeah.
Yeah, really, that's how it is. And you just do it. And so much fun. And but it's really fun is for ice fishing for pike, you set the traps and you wait and you're using huge shiners and you just jig and you're catching tons of big yellow perch while you're waiting. So you're you're not waiting around with nothing to do. You're catching perch while you're waiting for pike to catch, and then usually you get one or two little ones, and if you're lucky you get a big one.
Yeah. I'm trying to decide if I want to target them on the ice. They're so slow and moody. It's not very, you know, a trap.
You put out five traps, then you just jig. That's it.
Yeah, drink beer, I guess.
Drink beer, yeah. But it's a long drive and for a skunk.
Yeah. And well, the weird part is right down in Massachusetts, there's tons of pike, but it's just the areas you have to go. I don't like urban fishing, ghetto. Urban fishing. I don't like it when everyone goes, oh, make sure you don't leave anything in your car because it'll get robbed.
And I'm
like,
you paid your insurance off.
Yeah. So I don't, and it's just dirty. It's just the rivers there crummy, but there's tons of pike down there.
Well, you get down to like Lawrence, Massachusetts and stuff, and it's piles of fish down there. I mean, fishing in Lawrence is great anyway. And
it's just not the experience I like. I'd rather get skunked in the woods than haul in fish in the city, urban.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, that's pike fishing. So good. That's
the whole thing. Don't do it. Don't
bother.
And muskies on the list. When I was up in Wisconsin, there's muskie lakes. I couldn't catch those on anything. So that's going to be there someday.
I hear muskies are harder than pike.
Yeah, they're a fish of 10,000 casts or something. There's always something. But
yeah, I did a lecture at the Amiskake Fishways in Manchester once a few years back. And as a thank you, they gave me a mounted like 40-inch pike.
Thank you. Good, we got rid of it.
Oh, that's exactly, because they only want native fishes and they had it donated, and so it was no good for them. So it's hanging on my wife's kindergarten classroom wall, and the teeth on that are like 2 inches long. I mean, it's a scary animal.
Yeah, no, I can't remember. I was on Umbagog earlier this year, and I had a pike off the edge of my kayak, and it wasn't a pike, it was a pickerel, and it literally jumped up and it bit me in the arm, and I had teeth like a chunk taken out of my arm from a pickerel. I got pictures of it. It was really weird. There's like a ring of blood coming out of my arm.
Yeah. And their teeth are tiny compared to what you're trying to catch.
Right, yeah. But I didn't expect him to launch straight up in the air and chomp on my arm, but he was pissed.
So I was once canoeing, and I had a rubber worm dangling off the front of my canoe, probably a foot and a half out of the water. And while I was paddling across the lake, I caught a pickerel, jumped out of the water, and was just hanging from that rubber worm.
I love pickerel. They're so much easier and fun. They just don't get as big.
I haven't caught one pickerel the whole summer this year.
I didn't catch very many. Yeah. I don't know what was going on. I still don't know what happened this year. It was a weird year.
I don't know. It's going to be a weird winter too. So hopefully we just get through it.
Yeah. Well, there's nothing else to do but ice fish, I guess. So
I guess not.
Get used to it.
I'm waiting for the ice now. Get my shack ready to go. Cool. Mm. Awesome. Thanks, Rich Collins, for that story. And hope you get another pike before the season's over. Greg, you listened in on that one last night. What'd you think of it?
I did. It was great. I love hearing what Rich has to say.
Yeah, Rich is a good guy. He also saved our day. Our website host, we were on a page called iPages, and our website got hacked a few months ago. And Rich Collins, Rich Collins grabbed our stuff and rebuilt a brand new website for us. iPages, who was supposed to take care of us, wanted to charge me like $800 to save the day. I'm like, yeah, no.
And no, like, I got data rich.
From 11 years. And Rich is like, yeah, you don't need that garbage. So
yeah.
So he runs Thirst Productions is his game, and he runs makes web design stuff happen. So good.
Yeah.
So that's it. You know, you've made a whole podcast now. What'd you think about being on the podcast?
I loved being on the podcast.
It goes fast.
It does go fast, too fast. Call me back if you want me to do it again sometime.
I you never know. I love having a co-host. I try running a solo once in a while, and it's hard for me. So I'm super happy to have someone to bounce off of a little bit. So
I find the same thing with my podcast. I had a co-host at one point, and he moved on, and I did it solo for a few times, and it was horrible. But I have a co-host again. It's the best.
It's the best. Even like last week, my daughter Zoe co-hosted with me just because I need somebody else in the room. And
she did a great job. I want more Zoe.
Oh, everyone wants more Zoe. But she's we're doing remote learning with her right now, so she has to focus on learning math.
There you go. That's important. Math is important.
All right. There's a little script right in front of you, Greg.
Absolutely. That's it. You have listened to a bunch of fish nerds when you should have been fishing.
Big thanks to our families for tolerating this podcasting silliness, our Patreon supporters for funding the fun, Wally Pleasant and Diane's Bassalts for our music. Big fat thanks to Tim Beat and Rich Collins for putting together their correspondent work this week. And of course, Greg from the Unraveling podcast. Thank you for your time tonight. Appreciate you coming on.
Yeah, thanks, Clay. I've really enjoyed it. So until next time, follow the code of the fish nerds. Spawn early and often.
Never trust a free lunch with strings attached.
And swim against the current every chance you get.
You did it. You made a podcast. Congratulations.
I feel so special.
Getting those ankles wet. You're a hero.
Or deep in the ocean casting nets. Fish nerds.
Fish nerds. Fish nerds.
Fish nerds.
It's a podcast.
It's a podcast.
Just for the hell of it.
Fried in a basket or broiled in a pan. Eat it raw like you're in Siam. Fish nerds. Fish nerds. Fish nerds. It's a podcast.
It's a podcast. Isn't that a good theme song?
It's the best.
Yeah, that's Wally Pleasant, and I was a fan of his music when I was 18 years old. Huge fan. He was big in the college circuit and on pirate radio stations and underground stuff. He was in all the zines back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
And I went to see him play a few times. Man, he's great. And then I found out he had a book called 1001 Oyster Jokes, and I used that as leverage to get him on the podcast. And then while I had him on the show, I said, can you write me a theme song? And he did it for free.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So to go from a big fan to having one of my favorite artists make my music is pretty terrific.
Like a commission, a free commission.
I know. And he did it for nothing. I love it.
Yeah. Well, good job.
Well, congratulations. You made a podcast. I'm going to push stop on the recording. I'll keep you on here for a minute more.
Now
I'm recording.